Hi, I'm Tamara, and this is TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Hi, everyone. Today we are talking with author and scholar Jesse Thistle. You may have read his book, From the Ashes. If you haven't, you should read his book, From the Ashes. Today we're going to talk a little bit about his book and what Jesse is up to right now. And I am super excited, Jesse, to have you on the podcast. I've been wanting us to chat with you for quite some time. So welcome. Thank you.
Oh, nice to meet you, Tamara. It's nice to be here to talk with everyone and all the lovely people. So,
yeah. So, I mean, your book is, you're an incredible storyteller, but what struck me from your book was just how it feels like it's your heart on every page. And how would you describe your book to people that, like, do you describe it as a memoir?
Yeah, it's a memoir. It's fragments of memory, as much as I could remember, but told in a rolling narrative, interspersed with reflexive poetry. So that's how I would say it is. But it reads like a novel too, right? It's not your standard chronological memoir. I take you into individual memories and emotions, very specific, and I just keep doing that over and over, which is different than other memoirs. They're like a recounting of the things they did. I don't do that at all. I just immerse you in it, and it's like you're watching a movie of my life.
That's a good way to describe it. Also, I find that you can pick it up and just go to any chapter and start. Yes.
Yeah, and they're supposed to stand alone on their own, right? Because there's a lesson in each one. There's a message I'm telling in each one.
So for anyone listening that isn't familiar with your book or who you are, you were born in Prince Albert, Saskatchewan.
Yes.
You're Métis-Cree.
Yep.
And you had a very, a trauma-filled life, I guess, is one way of describing your life. How you got here?
That's an interesting question. I would say that my life, I think suffering is relative. And so to me, this was normal, right? This is my normal. And I just tried to find a better life in every day from, growing up all the way until now. And so that's the way I kind of see myself as to getting to where I am today. It's a story of the impacts of intergenerational trauma upon an Indigenous family. We're trying our best, but there's just the weight of history is against us. And I tell it in a way not to make the reader feel sorry for us, right? Or I'm not trying to lecture you. I'm just showing you what it's like to actually be an Indigenous person in Canada. And the things we have to grapple with, missing persons, addictions, landlessness, adoption, police brutality, all these things are in my book, right? And so I just show you what these systems feel like from the inside. So I guess it's a revealing look at colonialism through a family perspective.
For non-Indigenous people that don't understand what that means, or they don't understand how, your mom and dad's trauma affects you. Like why can't someone like you see the mistakes that maybe somebody else has made and not make those same mistakes, right? Like I'm looking at this through a lens of somebody who does not understand what intergenerational trauma is.
So what intergenerational trauma is, basically in a nutshell, is it's inherited post-traumatic stress disorder. So all the things that come from massive stress in your life, the dysfunction that comes from that, addiction, homelessness, mental health challenges, misogyny, all these things are wrapped up in it, right? And so for Métis people, our trauma happened historically with the Northwest Resistance when all of our land was taken. We were marginalized onto the sides of the roads as squatters, denied the right to own property, basically, not given any access to resources like health and education, And on top of that, our trauma or our losses was never recognized. We were just kind of erased by the state. And why that's important, I'll give you an example that I use sometimes in my lectures. World War I, right? This is a very traumatic thing that happened for Canada. Well, after the war, they put up epitaphs in all sorts of small towns all over to recognize the dead, to recognize the trauma, so that people could collectively grieve what had happened. We had lost a generation of our men. It scarred Canada. It was a horrible experience. You need that collective grieving and recognition of trauma to heal as a people. That never happened for Métis people. That our trauma just went ignored and was perpetuated over time. Because with trauma, there's a malformation of socialization. So people start acting funny. They're not the best parents. They develop addictions. You know, this is from socialization. And over time, that poverty on the road allowance compounded the trauma from the historic trauma that was passed down. And it just got worse all the way up until my mom and dad's generation, until our family just fell apart. And that in turn traumatized me because I went through, you know, the system and lost my culture and my language, all that stuff. And so that's what intergenerational trauma is and how what it actually does to families.
Mm-hmm. And I could, you know, your words and how you describe it in, especially in the earlier chapters with your dad and your mom and being at your grandma's and your, with your brothers. And I, you know, how little you were left alone at, you know, and as a parent myself, I, you know, I'm reading it and then you say how old you were, 3 or 4 years old and, you know, your brother's 5 or, and babysitting you basically. And it really, that's, I wasn't expecting that young of an age, right? It comes as a, something that I can relate to. I'm a parent, but then I see the pain that your mom and dad are also going through, right? And the fact that you could write about that and remember, and I realize that your memory is vague when you're that small, but things that are that traumatizing leave a lasting impact on you.
Yeah, they say that people that are traumatized are in many ways time travelers, right? Think of the most traumatic thing that's ever happened to you. Of course, you remember every detail. You just go back there. Sometimes you can't forget. That's what it's like to be traumatized. And so this has been happening to me since I was a young boy, you know, and just memories over and over. I have complex PTSD from that time that I'm still working through and I'm 45 years old, you know, so I want to forget this stuff, you know, I don't want to remember, you know, and so...
Is that where addiction comes in? Is that where it comes in? Because we need to numb it. We need to forget about it. We need to feel good, even if it's just for a few minutes.
Definitely. Trauma, they know for a fact that adverse childhood experiences that are traumatic, like what had happened to me and my brothers, definitely is like a... That's the gateway drug, trauma, right? It's not marijuana or cigarettes, it's trauma. And so, you know, if you have a life full of that and it's not of your own doing, of course it leads to later addiction. And, you know, I also didn't learn to love and trust, and that's like the foundation of human interaction with my parents. They were just not there, and that's who you learn that from, right? You learn to love and trust from your parents. And so... In that void, I just crammed all these drugs later in my life, self-medicating as well as to numb myself out, you know?
And you started, you started doing drugs in your teens.
Well, I started drinking when I was like 4 and 5, actually, with my buddy Leroy. And my dad used to give us beer to as like a supplement for food. Right. Like the leftover beer. So it's just something that was always in my life. It was normalized at such a young age. I didn't continually drink, of course, but like when I was six, I drank with my buddy Leroy. I remember, you know, when I was 12 drinking, and then I got into the drugs when I was about 15.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then after that came, I mean, you were homeless.
Yeah.
You were getting into trouble. And you were surrounded by other people really too, weren't you, Jesse? You know, that were sort of, I guess, experiencing the same, their own trauma.
Yeah, 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 of course. It's like on the fringes of society, the liminal people that we don't like to talk about too much, that's where I lived, you know. I guess it's like straight out of a Bukowski book from the 70s. You know, those are the people he was writing about. I was one of those people.
Do you look back on it now? And I mean, it wasn't that long ago. You're still so young. Do you look back on it and does it seem real still, or does it in some ways seem surreal?
It's more real than my life now.
Mm.
It's more real. I don't trust now. I'm like, I'm a professor. I'm a best-selling author. I'm all these things that people tell me are, but I can't convince myself otherwise that I'm not a homeless addict. And like I used to, and there's a poem at the end of my book where I'd wake up in the middle of the night and wander out in my underwear into the backyard to go to sleep. And Lucy used to have to chase me sleepwalking. That's because there's a calling within my spirit somewhere. There's my soul still thinks I'm that person that I was. And I don't know if I'll ever escape that, you know? So I just have to manage.
Mm. Yeah. So yeah, your poetry is beautiful. Did you always write? Have you always written?
No, I started writing and reading in jail when I was 32 years old onward. So, and poetry was one of the earliest forms of me expressing myself because, you know, there's no rules really. You can just write whatever comes to you and there's no, at least I never learned the rules. So that's the way I write, you know.
Well, you write in, it's so descriptive. It's like the reader is right there with you. You know, do you think that Canadians know a lot about the Métis culture?
No. There's a misunderstanding. They think that Métis means mixed bloodedness, that it's a mix between First Nations and European forefathers and mothers. That's a racialized logic of who we are. Sure, our ancestors were that, but our people fought for their rights politically as like a collective in 1885. That's what makes us a nation of people. We asserted our will politically as a nation, right? And so another example from World War I, if you look at Vimy Ridge, they say that's when Canada really became a nation because we fought collectively for the same cause as Canadians. Where before that, we were more of like a, I don't know, dominion of, you know, the British Empire. That was when we earned our stripes as a nation. And so that's how Métis people themselves see themselves, right? It's our struggles, our political assertions over time that make us a nation of people with our own unique languages, our own unique culture. We had our own ethnogenesis, a fluorescence of culture too, that's separate from either First Nations or Europeans. And that alone, all this, what I'm talking about, that collectively makes us Métis. It's not just about our racialized logic or.
Mm-hmm. When I was reading your book, I didn't know what road allowance was.
No, not a lot of people do.
I had no idea. And I thought, how did I get to this point in my life and not know, how did I not learn about this in school? How do I not know this?
Well, you learn the first half, I'm sure. You learned about the Northwest Resistance and Louis Riel. We all are, you know, if you've taken grade 10 history in Canada, you learn about the Métis struggle. You don't learn why they're struggling. You just hear that there was a conflict. And you don't hear what happened afterwards to Riel's people, to the Métis. Well, what happened was we were stripped of our Aboriginal title to land on an individual basis. Through a process called scrip. So they gave us these little coupons where we were to settle land that really wasn't desirable, or we could sell it. And we chose to sell this land. And because we didn't have treaty and we looked Indigenous, we couldn't access settler society and we couldn't go on to reservations or reserves with First Nations. So the only place that we could live was in between the square lot homestead settlements on Crown land, where there was to be an allotment or an allowance for a road or some sort of infrastructure like a railway. That was public Crown land that nobody wanted. And so the Métis congregated there and formed these little makeshift villages, tar paper shacks at first, log houses. And we lived there as squatters for 100 years without access to education, without access to healthcare. Any of this, like there are certain historians like Gerald Friesen says, it's really the greatest injustice in Canada that happened to Indigenous people. And we don't even talk about it. The nation doesn't even know, you know. There's a very few chorus of new scholars that are coming out and starting to talk about it because they themselves come from road allowance families. But outside of that, not the general public really doesn't know.
So how do we change that? How do we work together so that people understand the history in this country?
Well, we do it through cool podcasts like this, right?
Yeah.
We do it through books, through literature, right? You got to win people's hearts and show them the damage, right?
Yes.
What actually happened? And once you capture their hearts like that, then you can introduce them to the historical texts, the monographs, the journal articles about road allowance history. And that's what I do. That's my other job. My other profession is a professor that teaches that. And I'll continue to teach that until enough people know about my history that I don't get asked questions like this. People just know.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I want to ask you more about that. But before we do that, I wanted to mention NAMI Res in Toronto. So something that TELUS has been doing with our guests is we find, you know, a way to give back in a way that's meaningful to our guests. And I know for you, NAMI Res is important, and we will be giving them $500 on your behalf. And I'm just curious as to, you know, why you chose NAMI Res.
No one has ever asked me that before. And there's a very important reason. Me and my brother, Jerry, don't get along right now. And I love him. He's the closest person to me apart from my wife. He knows me better than anybody. In the book, he rescued me over and over. And there's a little bitterness between us because of that. Jerry had his own trouble with addictions and homelessness and whatnot. And I can't help him. Can't directly help because we just fight. And so my way of helping my brother is helping one of the agencies that helps him today. So I give there with the hopes that that money maybe will trickle down to him and help him. So that's why I do that.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Wow. You can't help somebody that doesn't want help, can you?
No. No, it comes down, and this is a hard discussion to have. It does come down to choice sometimes. You know, you do need to have the supports there to help people choose better for themselves. That's the second half of the equation. But the person needs to want to change, right? And yeah. So you can't have one without the other, right? And in this way, that's the whole discussion that needs to happen, right? Mm-hmm. I know this from experience, right? I had a lot of people for many years trying to change me and offering me all kinds of help. And it wasn't until I was ready and wanted to that I could change. But I needed those people to be there with their catcher's mitts to give me the opportunity to choose better for myself. So I needed both, right?
What was your tipping point?
It's kind of a collection of things, I guess. Like my body was giving out my second time in rehab, I was dying, you know, and I knew that I was incontinent. I couldn't control my system. And something kicks in the human spirit when you know you're going to die and it's an outside force, that it's not a choice of your own. All you want to do is live. You see this in people that are like stage 4 cancer or whatever. They just want a second chance at life. And I got that, you know. Also, the way that I went into treatment the second time, I was bailed out by Harvest House. They posed as my surety. They have like a paralegal that went into the justice system. And for years, I'd been trying to get into treatment. And I don't know if anybody's ever tried, but it's almost impossible in Canada unless you have some really robust work program that pays for treatment. And so I'd get to detox and I'd always try to go, but they'd say, oh, we'll take you in 6 to 8 months. You know, just wait it out. And I'm like, I'm homeless. I have nowhere to go. How am I going to do that? And so as soon as I left detox, I just go back out to my addictions. And so Harvest House offered me that bridge directly in, and the courts too. And that's how I got to rehab. And that's ultimately saved my life. And then when I was there, I saw that this institution and the people around me that were trying to help me, actually, they loved me and wanted to give me a second chance. It's run by former addicts, right? So they really understood my situation. And in that, I made amends with my grandma and grandpa, and I became whole and in a lot of ways, you know. And so there's just so much I could say about that part of my life, you know.
I know. And that's where you started writing, right? You started writing on a blog?
I started writing actually in rehab. I write things down on like cue cards and do my amends, they're called. And I have to stand up in group therapy called professional development and share with all the other addicts all the things that I did and things that happened to me in my addiction. And I collected those after I got out for years through my undergrad. And I started throwing that up on a blog, and that I collected. It was kind of like a storehouse of my amendments. And that's really what the book is. That's a collection of those little fragments of my memory from my program.
Because in some ways, and this, I mean, this is ridiculous for me to say right now, but I'm just going to say it. For an outsider looking in, right, here you are, a best-selling author. You are an assistant prof at York University. You're successful. You're, you know, you made it look, right now it looks easy.
Yeah.
And it's not easy. No. Is it possible that people could resent you for your success? Do you ever feel that way? Do you feel like, he doesn't understand anymore? He, you know.
Yeah. They think, oh, it wasn't that bad. You know, he didn't have it like I did, you know. What he went through must have been easier than me. And there are a lot of people that resent me, you know. They'll say, oh, look at this guy. He's portraying this bootstrap narrative, all this BS, right? It's not. It was a lot of hard work with people that loved me and held me up. That's how I got better. And so there are even my own relatives. I believe my brother feels that way, that he looks at me and he's like, you know, resentful that I'm doing well because I've, you know, changed who I am. And it's incredibly hard. He was talking with my mom from what she told me, and he's trying to make progress. And he's like, he just made it look so easy. And it really wasn't. It was like the hardest thing that I'll ever do in my life. And I'm not okay now. Like, that's another fallacy. People think, oh, because you're successful, quote unquote. Like, I have complex PTSD. I have suicidal ideation. I always fantasize about like suicide and killing myself. And that's a product of trauma, right? And I have to work hard in therapy. Every month I have things I got to work through. And so in many ways, I have survivor guilt too. Like, why did I make it out where all my friends are dead now, or they're gone to prison, or they've lost their minds? How come I'm okay? And I guess that's how it would feel if you got in a car crash with your family, you know, and you're the only one that survives. You know, that's how I feel every day. And so I wouldn't say it's success. You know, I'm just managing to be better than I was yesterday, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it totally makes sense. What about more writing? What about, is this something that you see yourself doing, like writing more books, so that you said, you know, that's how we do better and we learn together is by sharing stories and reading stories. Do you feel like that is I can't take your course at York University, but I can read your book and learn from your words. So how else do you see yourself writing more?
Yes. I'm signed a contract with Simon & Schuster to tell my great uncle Ronnie's kind of his life, but it's going to be fictionalized. He was a bank robber in the 70s and 80s. And so, but really it's a story about what residential schools did to Indigenous men and how they, you know, they're overrepresented in the prison population. And I want it to be an advocacy piece, you know, because these rates of incarceration are actually a product of nation state building at the expense of Indigenous peoples. And so I'm going to write about that. I got to write my dissertation. You know, I'm going to continue to write academically as well. So I have two fields that I write in, and I'll continue to write, you know. I think I'm part of a generation of younger Indigenous storytellers that are coming out and sharing our truths. And that's a wonderful thing. Like the Shuri Dimaline, she's a Métis author. She really kicked the door down for us all. I would say since like around 2010. And so we're coming out with our own stories, and the larger publishers are finally noticing that we are profitable too. We're not just telling our little niche story for our little market. We're dominating the charts. And so there's a real interest, right? And there's mm-hmm. a danger in that too, though, right? Because we could be white streamed. They could take our narratives, fashion them into what's recognizable for the white audience in a performative way. And so in us telling our truths, in a, you know, being heavily involved in the editing process as well, the clarity of our stories are finally coming out for the first time. Mm-hmm. And that's a wonderful thing. And I would say just, you know, promote and support Indigenous writers where you can, and show those bigger publishers that we are profitable mm-hmm. and that to tell our stories in our own way.
What do you say to people who say there's no such thing as systemic racism in Canada?
I just think they don't know enough. They just don't know enough. And I would say they're the fish in the water. You know, the fish doesn't know it's in water because that's just all they know, and they benefit from it. It's like it's the those that are impacted by systemic racism, of course, know the most about it, right? And they're marginalized people that have to swim against the stream to just be heard and have normal family lives and, you know, own homes like other people. And so there are these barriers that are in place. Mm-hmm. And my life is a testament to that. You know, I'm other Indigenous peoples is too. So.
Mm-hmm. And what are you reading right now?
Great question.
There's a lot of books beside you. What book is that?
This is In My Own Moccasins by Helen Knott. Brilliant writer, Indigenous writer. Came out last year. See what else.
I like that. I'm writing these down.
David Robertson, Blackwater. So my story is traumatic, right? And it's about the fracturing of my family and addiction. David's about reconnecting with his father, who was like a workaholic. And that's an Indigenous story too of our families. And that's a reaction to trauma too. And so I really suggest people go and read this. He's a wonderful man. And I've been on a lot of panels with him. And
okay.
Want to get a lot. Yeah. Blackwater. Yeah.
Yeah. I will put both of those on my list right now.
Yeah.
Jesse, you are wonderful to speak with. And I really appreciate your openness to have this conversation. Your book is wonderful. I wish I could take your class. Surely there must be a way to do this online. But you're great. And so thank you so much for spending the time with us. Please remember that you can get Jesse's book From the Ashes anywhere that you purchase books. It's a great holiday present, or if you're isolating, there's you can read this book. You won't be able to put it down, I promise. Jesse is on Facebook at Thistle Jesse, and also your website is jessethistle.ca, right?
Yes.
Yes.
No, .com.
.com. Sorry, yeah. .com. Or just yes. Google Jesse Thistle and all kinds of fun stuff will come up. Jesse, right. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for listening to another episode of TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Be sure to subscribe so you can join us every Tuesday for another conversation. You can also check out our website, telus.com/podcast, and subscribe to our YouTube channel at TELUS Talks.